Welcome to the CANape Quick Start. In this video, we'll be talking about CASL programming in CANape. CASL stands for Calculation and Scripting Language, and it is CANape's C-like programming language. You can access CASL objects via the function editor. When you open the function editor, you see four main categories of items. The first one is global variables. Global variables are project-wide objects that can be included as measurements or calibrations. Additionally, these are different than local variables in the sense that they can be called across any function or script. Next, you have functions. Functions are CASL programs that are useful for measurement or analysis. You also have scripts. Scripts are CASL programs that are useful for project automation. We'll talk about the difference between functions and scripts very soon. Lastly, we have seed and key algorithms. These are encryption algorithms that are used to unlock communication with a device. We've previously seen this when setting up a device in CANape in order to unlock it. There are two types of functions. There are virtual functions and online functions. Virtual functions are used to analyze past measurements. When you set up a virtual function, this is automatically included in the data mining editor. Next, you have online functions. Online functions are included in future measurements via the measurement configuration. This means that your online function will be included in any future measurement file you record. Additionally, functions only run synchronous with the measurement. This means that functions only run when CANape is running a measurement. Next, we have scripts. Scripts are asynchronous, meaning they can be started independently of measurement and can run at any point in a CANape project. You can also configure scripts to run on certain project conditions, for example, opening your project, loading a measurement file, or any other action. In this tutorial, I'll be using the CANape Comprehensive Vehicle Demo Example Project. If you look at the Symbol Explorer, you'll see a category called Function Definitions. Within Function Definitions, there are two subcategories. There are library functions, and there are project functions. Project functions are CASL functions that the user has created from the function editor in CANape. This section will only appear once you have created your own functions. These are also different than where scripts are located. The next section is library functions, and these are pre-built in CANape. The first section I have is called Amidon functions, named after me. It's quite easy to export your functions into the global function library from within the function editor. The first pre-built section is called Base Mathematics, and in here you will find absolute value and derivative, among other functions. The next section is Boolean algebra for bitwise and/or operations. Next is E-mobility analyzer for electric motor phase analysis, for example. In filter, you'll find a high-pass filter. Signal analysis is for Fourier transforms, for example. You can see if signals are equal in signal comparison. Signal generator allows you to make a square or sawtooth wave, and then statistics allows you to find the max value of a signal. Now let's open up the function editor. In the left pane, you can see all the scripts that were previously included in this demo project. We'll create our own script by right-clicking and selecting New. We're going to use this script just to start a measurement. Because of this, I'm simply going to call this function start. You can see the file type for CASL scripts is .cns. You can import these across functions. I'm now going to check the box next to show script in the program menu. By default, CASL scripts have to be open from your Windows directory. However, if you select this box, you can conveniently start your CASL script right from your CANape project. Once I press OK, my new script will appear, and I'm ready to start coding. I'm simply going to type start, since this is the function to start a measurement. On the taskbar at the top, there are many convenient buttons you can use when writing a script. If I go to the beginning of my line of code, I can create a line comment by pressing this light turquoise button. The button right next to it allows you to uncomment. I'm now going to write a new line of code as a placeholder. I'll use the function to stop a measurement. If I select both lines of code, I can use the same button to comment out. This time it'll be a block comment rather than a line comment. The same button to remove comments can be used for block comments as well. Now I'm going to remove my stop function since I don't need it. I'm also going to right-click and bring up the context menu. Within the context menu, there's an option at the bottom that says Insert. You'll see multiple different categories. Variables allow you to bring up variables from within your devices. Menu commands allow you to execute different functions from CANape within your script. Constructs allow you to perform bitwise operations within your script, for example. These are contained in the bit manipulation operators. You can also find for loops, while loops, and do while statements in the control structures category. Next is the functions tab, which contains every supported CASL function. First is application functions, which allows you to control CANape's behavior. Then device functions, which allows you to activate your device, go online, or change your database, for example. Then measurement, which is where you'll find the start function that we already use in our script. If you continue to hover over each of the tabs, it'll allow you to see exactly which functions are supported in CASL. You might be wondering how to use each of these functions, though. If we go back to the start function we already used, I'll show how. While your cursor is hovering over the function, press the F1 key to open the syntax help menu. Each and every supported CASL function has this super helpful syntax guide. If you look at the top, it shows you when you can use the function. For instance, the start function can only be used during measurement, not during real time, since the measurement's already running in real time. Syntax shows you the form of the function, and parameters tells you how to pass in optional control values. Additionally, each syntax page has at least one example of how to use the function. One additional benefit of scripts is the ability to debug them. You can simply click in the margin of the script to create a breakpoint. Now if I click Run, this is simply asking me if I want to save the script, I can run the script right to the breakpoint. The yellow arrow is indicating that I've run my script to this breakpoint. Now if I click Step Into, I can debug my code line by line. There are multiple tabs at the bottom. If I click on the Variables tab, this is the tab that will show me live values of my script as I debug line by line. Next, I can go to the Breakpoints tab and I can see all of my breakpoints. I can toggle them by switching the checkpoint. I can also click on the breakpoint to highlight it, and then right-clicking will give me the menu where I can delete it. Now that I'm done debugging, I'm ready to use my script. I'm going to click the Save icon on the top left, and then Compile. The Compile button is located near the center of the taskbar. You'll then be able to see whether or not your program compiled in the window at the bottom. The button right next to Compile is Compile All, which allows you to see if you have any syntax errors in any function or script. We're now done writing our script, and we can move on to creating a new function. Right-click on Project Functions and select New to create a new one. I'm going to call this Add because I'm going to use this function to add the value of two signals together. The function is now created with the default template. The parentheses next to the function definition are for the input values. This is where you can pass values from your CANape project into your script. The signals I'll use are channel 1 and channel 3, which will link to our device signals later on. Now that we've passed these values to the script, they're ready to use. The return statement is where the function defines the value that you want the function to output as a measurement signal. Since this function is intended to add the value of two signals, we're going to return the value of channel 1 plus channel 3. This will allow CANape to show the value of the two signals added together in a graphic window once it's in our project. Now that my function's written, I'm going to click Save and then Compile. Since we have no compile errors, we're ready to go. The Wave Generator tab is where my signals are located, so I'm going to navigate there. I'm just going to combine channel 1 and channel 3 onto one graphic window to make it easier to see. I'm also going to close a few of these other windows. There are a few different ways to add your function to your project. The first is by right-clicking the graphic window and selecting Insert Measurement Signal. Once the measurement configuration opens, we can navigate down to the Functions tab to see any functions we have in our project. Next, you can right-click and select Insert Function. The function definition window opens and you can see all of the library functions first. If we scroll down to the bottom, we'll find the project function we just created. We had to navigate through a lot of windows to add this function though, so in my opinion there's an easier way. I'm going to cancel without adding and go back to the Symbol Explorer. On the Symbol Explorer, there's a category called Function Definitions. You can also see the Add function we just created here. When I drag it onto the graphic window, I can add it as a virtual measurement file channel, which means it'll be included in any future data mining, or a measurement function, which means it'll be included in any future measurements. I'm going to select Measurement function, and then the Online function window appears. You see channel 1 and channel 3 have exclamation points next to them because they're not yet linked with anything. This is the stage where we link it. There's two buttons at the bottom, Link Automatically and Link Manually. For the first one, when we link channel 1, we're going to use Link Manually. Since channel 1 and channel 3 are already included in my measurement configuration, I can just choose measurement signals instead of my device. I just have to select channel 1 and then click Apply. Now when I look at the function window again, you can see that channel 1 is linked with Busy Driver channel 1. For channel 3, I'm going to choose Link Automatically. I know I have a signal called channel 3 in my Busy Driver device, so I'm going to select this. Now I can see that channel 1 and channel 3 are both linked, even though we use different methods to link them. If I click Edit, I can see my function. Because I used channel 1 and channel 3 as my input signal names, I was able to use Link Automatically because I knew this was the name of my signals from my device. Now that my function is in my graphic window, we're ready to use both the function and script. If I click the drop-down under Execute, I can start my script to start the measurement. I'll let my measurement run for about 10 seconds. You can also see the value of my function changing in real time. This is because it was included as a measurement function instead of a virtual function. Now, once I'm done running my measurement, I can check the value of my function. I'm going to turn on the measurement cursor to be able to verify this. Channel 1 is 0.83, channel 3 is 0.944. This means that add is equal to channel 1 plus channel 3, or 1.77, which we know is correct.